Judges chapter 10, we take the second look at the book of Judges tonight and finish this book. Judges 10, let's read from God's word, verses 10 through 16. Then the Israelites cried out to the Lord, "We have sinned against you, forsaking our God and serving the Baals." The Lord replied, "When the Egyptians, the Amorites, the Ammonites, the Philistines, the Sidonians, the Amalekites, and the Maonites oppressed you and you cried to me for help, did I not save you from their hands? But you have forsaken me and served other gods, so I will no longer save you. Go and cry out to the gods you have chosen. Let them save you when you are in trouble." But the Israelites said to the Lord, "We have sinned. Do with us whatever you think best, but please rescue us now." Then they got rid of the foreign gods among them and served the Lord, and he could bear Israel's misery no longer. Amen. This is God's word, and let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the offer of mercy that we see even in these verses, that you relent of the calamity that you send our way. It brings you no pleasure to see your people in distress. Even the prophet Ezekiel cries out that the Lord takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked, that your command is that they would turn and live. God, grant that tonight we will be warned by this example from the Old Testament. As Paul said to the Corinthians, these things were written as examples to warn us that we would not lust after idolatry and forbidden things as they did. Grant that we will take heed to this example, and that we will see the gospel in this story, that even when we go down headlong into destruction, you rescue your people from their sins because of your mercy. So grant us understanding, may our knowledge of the word grow, may we yield ourselves in obedience to it. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're coming back again tonight to the book of Judges. And I said last Sunday when we began to look at this book, it's kind of a great contrast to the book of Joshua. Joshua is quite optimistic and hopeful. It's a record of Israel's, for the most part, obedience. Whereas Judges is much more negative and darker, a record of Israel's disobedience to the Lord and his covenant. You may remember from Deuteronomy that the Lord said, when you go into the land, there's these two mountains, and I want half the tribes to stand in front of one mountain, and I want the other six tribes to stand in front of the other. And one group will read the blessings of the law, and the other will read the curses. And so it will be a symbolic gesture, a religious, organized time in which they'd read the law, and there would be this symbolism of things can either go well or things can either go poorly. There can be life or there can be death. Now, one of the things that the Old Covenant does, the Mosaic Covenant that God instituted at Sinai, that governed Israel until the time of Christ, one of the things it does is highlight disobedience and death. By its very structure, it tethers a blessing to obedience. There is an emphasis on do this and you will live. And that is not to say there is no grace in the Old Testament. It's not to say there's no grace in the Mosaic Covenant. Christ was preached to them, presented to them through the sacrifices at least, through the words of the prophets. They were admonished to believe as Abraham did. So there's much grace and faith in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant era. And yet at the same time, God designed that covenant a certain way in order to emphasize a particular message, that disobedience brings death. Obedience is the way to life. God would put his law before Israel in that old covenant and show them no one can be perfectly righteous. And when you are unrighteous, these are the penalties in order to drive us to faith in Christ. So if Joshua really illustrates the life of the old covenant, when God's people obey him, there is a blessing. So Judges illustrates in a very dark way that the wages of sin is death. By the time we're done tonight, we'll see that, but we'll also be reminded of God's gift of life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we broke Judges up into three sections. The first one is the introduction, where the downward spiral is anticipated for the book. And back in chapter 2, you may remember that there was that summary of the book, and it was hinted at here in chapter 10 that whenever Israel would descend into idolatry, God would give them over to oppressors. And under the oppressors, they would cry out for deliverance. And God, in his mercy, would send them a judge who would deliver them, and they would enjoy rest, and they would leave their idols for a time. But usually after the judge died, they would return to their idolatry, and so the downward cycle would repeat until God again showed them mercy as they repented. That is the situation that came on the scene after the death of Joshua. Without that godly leadership, without that competent leadership to unify the nation in obedience to God, the next generation did not follow the Lord. They instead descended into sin. And the two particular sins that really come to the forefront in Judges are idolatry and intermarriage. That Israel would have other gods and that they would intermarry with people that adopted those other gods. Again, not an ethnic statement, not a statement you could use to make policy about what different nations should marry one another, but definitely a statement by which we could say that different religions should not marry one another, or that those who are in Christ should only marry in the Lord. For when there are a marriage with one that knows the Lord and one does not, the weight, the pull away from the Lord is very hard to resist. Now again, God is gracious. Often an unsaved spouse is saved. Paul will say in 1 Corinthians 7, if you have an unsaved spouse, well, even your children, though, are still holy. As long as there's one believing parent in that marriage and with those children, then you are still members federally of the church. You have a right to its blessings, and therefore they are not to be shunned or turned away. But nonetheless, God warns to not marry in the Lord, pulls the heart away and entices one towards those other gods. And we see that particularly in action and Judges as idolatry just creeps into Israel and takes over, and they begin this downward spiral. Now, the middle of the book is where most of the action takes place and where the book gets its name. Chapters 3 through 16 give us the reign of these judges, these military leaders that would come for a season and fight and lead Israel's armies and deliver them from the oppression of these foreign nations that were coming in, raiding their land, taking their food, making them live in fear and hiding. Some of the judges actually judge like we think of a judge. They would settle disputes, much like what we read in Exodus 18. But often they led Israel in military campaigns and delivered them from their enemies. Now, the way the judges start, they seem like class characters, men and women that are leading Israel in a good way. Nothing negative said about the earliest judges. As the story progresses, we get Gideon, and Gideon's a hero. We tell his story to our children, but even with Gideon, we start to see reason for concern. Gideon is fearful. He needs the episode with the fleeces. God has to not only command him, but really show Gideon that he means what he says in going out to lead Israel's armies. After the story that we're mainly familiar with, Gideon is established as a leader, a ruler, a judge there in Israel. And he, at one point, fashions a golden ephod, which becomes a snare for idolatry. If you look back to chapter 8 in verse 27, I believe we read this last week, but we'll read this again. Chapter 8, verse 27, Gideon made the gold into an ephod, which he placed in Ophrah, his town. All Israel prostituted themselves by worshiping it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and his family. So here's Gideon, and yes, he delivers Israel. Yes, God uses him. He's a flawed man. We all are. But these are red flags. This is the sign that maybe not all is well with these judges, that they're compromised leaders, not entirely dedicated to the Lord or free from all calls to idolatry. The point comes where the people want to make Gideon king. Now, Gideon resists this move. So they therefore go and make his son Abimelech king instead. Gideon had many sons, many wives, some concubines and whatnot, and they make one of his sons from one of his wives, Abimelech, they attempt to make him king, because Gideon himself will not be king. Now, back in Deuteronomy 17, God had said, here's how it's going to go when it's time to make a king. God will choose the king. The king will protect the people. He will follow the law. And he will lead the nation to serve the Lord. He's a representative figure that's supposed to promote righteousness and worship of the true God in the land. Abimelech is none of these things. He is not chosen by God. He's chosen by the people. He does not protect the people. He does not follow the law, and he does not lead the nation to serve the Lord. In fact, one of the very first actions that he takes as king is to murder his 70 brothers. Like I said, these are all from Gideon's family, as many wives. So lest there be any competition for the throne, he puts to death his 70 brothers so that he alone can be king. Now, what that tells us is he himself is not a righteous man, obviously. And the people who would choose him, the people who would choose this kind of king, well, they're self-serving as well. They say, well, he'll be good, he'll be a good ruler, he'll be strong for us. They're using him as an opportunity to get what they want. So in putting this man over them, both king and people show themselves to be not wholly devoted to the Lord. And thus it is a sign of the sinful times going on within the nation of Israel. As we come out of that episode, we come into chapter 10 and notice again this description of Israel's idolatry. Look at chapter 10, verse 6. Chapter 10, verse 6. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They served the Baals and the Ashtoreths, and the gods of Aram, the gods of Sidon, the gods of Moab, the gods of the Ammonites, and the gods of the Philistines. And because the Israelites forsook the Lord and no longer served him, he became angry with them. We'll end there. This is a long list of other gods that Israel serves. What gods did they not worship? I mean, there's only so many nations around them. It seems they've adopted every god but the Lord, but Jehovah, Yahweh, the God who is in covenant with them. And they'll still have lip service to him, as we'll see at the end of the book. But they've just mixed all these gods into their worship. In the verses that we read at the opening of our time tonight show God's response. Now, probably in a sense, verse 6 is something of a summary of the whole period. Again, this stretches for a couple hundreds of years. It goes on around all of the land of Israel. So that's all those different tribes. Some of these times and seasons overlap. So this is probably a summary of this is just how bad it was during this period. But because of this great sinfulness, God's response is to give the people over to their own actions and to oppress them. To say, okay, you adopt the gods of the other nations? Well, then the other nations will come and oppress you. Let's see if their gods can deliver you from their hand or from my hand. How will they rescue you and provide for you like I can? But notice that towards the end of chapter 10, they cry out to the Lord. They say, we've sinned. Rescue us now. And they get rid of the foreign gods. And what does God do? He delivers them because he could bear their misery no longer. What a compassionate God. It's not, he couldn't stand them any longer. They had done enough where there'd be no more mercy and grace. He can't stand the fact that they're in misery. So great is God's love for his creation and his people that he delights to relieve the misery of his people, particularly when they repent and seek him. So there's a window into the way things are going during this time. Now, that brings us at the end of chapter 10 and into 11. To the judge known as Jephthah. Now, Jephthah, again, is going to be another mixed character. He will be used of the Lord to deliver Israel, and yet he will show signs of flaws. Look at chapter 11, verse 24. Flaw isn't a good word, just downright sin. But chapter 11, verse 24, here he is interacting with one of these foreign nations. And he says, will you not take what your God Chemosh gives you? Likewise, whatever the Lord our God has given us, we will possess. So in some of these conversations about raids and land, he says, well, hey, look, Chemosh, your God has given you land. You take that. And we'll take the land that the Lord our God has given us. So he's possibly giving recognition to one of these false gods. Now, maybe he's being sarcastic. I grant that. The prophets do that sometime. They'll refer to the other gods in a sarcastic way and say, well, where are those gods? Let's let them show up. Elijah does that on Mount Carmel. So maybe Jephthah's just being sarcastic in that way. But look on to verse 30 and 31. As he prepares to fight, we read this, and Jephthah made a vow to the Lord, if you give the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out of the door of my house to meet me when I return in triumph from the Ammonites will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. So he says, whatever comes out of the door of my house when I get home will be sacrificed as a burnt offering. Now, that you may think, well, what does he think is going to come out the door of his house? Not uncommon for there to be some animals in and out of the house the way the houses were built. But he's foolish, and what he doesn't expect is verse 34. When Jephthah returned to his home in Mizpah, who should come out to meet him but his daughter, dancing to the sound of timbrels? She was an only child. Except for her, he had neither son nor daughter. Now, I don't think when he made the vow, he was thinking that a human would come out. I think he was expecting an animal. But nonetheless, when she comes out, instead of then renouncing the vow or finding some way to get out of his vow, and there would have been provisions for that within the law itself, he goes on and says, verse 35, when he saw her, he tore his clothes and cried, oh no, my daughter, you have brought me down and I am devastated. I have made a vow to the Lord that I cannot break. Now, we won't read on, but interestingly enough, his daughter actually goes along with this vow. And in the end, I believe that she's given up as a burnt offering. Now, some have come to this story, and they are distressed over that. How could this judge burn his daughter as a burnt offering to the Lord? And the attempt is made to get Jephthah out of it. So, for example, somewhere in Leviticus, forgive me, I didn't look up the reference, but the priests are described as a wave offering before the Lord. So just as you would take some of the grain and wave it before the Lord. So there's one passage where the priests are called a wave offering. We didn't pick the priest up and wave them around. It's something of a non-literal sense. The priests are dedicated to the Lord like a wave offering. So some have come to Jephthah and tried to say, he did not burn his daughter to death. He dedicated her to the Lord as a burnt offering, like you would a burnt offering. He gave her entirely to the Lord to be dedicated to her. And there was this group of women that lived like a monastic lifestyle, and they were the Lord's dedicated ones. I don't think we need to get Jephthah out of this situation like that. We're not supposed to think that Jephthah is doing a good thing here. Remember, this is a bad time in Israel. When we get to the very end of the message, you'll see just how bad it was. Religion is being forsaken, true religion. Idols are being incorporated into Israel's religion. And even the judges that God gives are not themselves wholly devoted to the Lord. I think Jephthah did a foolish thing and burned his daughter in a religious sense, because so dark and twisted is Israel during this time. We should read that and just be appalled and aghast that things would get so bad in Israel. That's what happens when we forsake God and cling to other gods. That's what happens when we start to follow the imaginations of our heart and start worshiping God the way we think he should be worshiped instead of how he tells us he should be worshiped. This is why when we say that the Bible alone is our guide, that's a good thing. That's just not being strict and mean and puritanical. If you're left to your own to figure out how to worship God, that's what kind of things you'll come up with. Things that kill and destroy. When you follow God's gracious word, which is the record of Christ who loves us and gave himself for us, then you will worship God in an acceptable way, in a way that brings glory to him, in a way that is humane and just, and all those things, and so much more, because it's the truth of the living God. This is why God says, you don't make me in your image. You don't know what I look like. And that's supposed to be an object lesson for, you can't figure me out yourselves. But good news, I'll tell you what I'm like. I'll tell you how you're to worship me. And you'll use my name rightly, and it will be good and restful for your souls. You see how those opening commandments weave together to give us the right way to worship a gracious God so that it leads to life. So I think Jephthah here makes a very foolish and wicked decision, because so bad is the situation in Israel. And if there's some dispute still over Jephthah, the final judge, there's no argument, is there? Samson. As things hit rock bottom in Israel. Samson is a Nazarite, chapters 13 through 16, which means that he must do three things. He must avoid strong drink, he must avoid dead bodies, and he must avoid haircuts. That doesn't sound too hard, does it? Particularly the third, right, guys? Don't cut your hair. Stay away from dead bodies. Stay away from a strong drink. All voluntary activities which one could fulfill as unto the Lord. This is a vow that could be kept. If you keep those three in mind and then read the story of Samson, you will see how he breaks all three. Touches the dead body of the lion to get the honey. He wants something to eat. He wants a sweet treat. So he breaks his vow. How he is involved in strong drink. He is often drunk. He is also involved with foreign women, a theme there in Judges, as he is a slave to his appetites and involved with all manner of women. And in the end, obviously the well-known story, Delilah is able to entice him into cutting his hair, at which point he is captured by the Philistines, his eyes are put out, and he is made to grind and entertain them at their idolatrous party. Now, in the end, he cries out to the Lord, "Give me one more chance to avenge against the Philistines." I take that as a genuine heartfelt prayer, because if you read Hebrews 11, Samson is included among the heroes of the faith, which shows God's grace so you can make a wreck of your life and cry out to God for mercy, and he will indeed save you. I don't think when he tears the temple down that we should read that as suicide. I'm not saying that no believer ever does that. Just saying this is not an example of that. I would take Samson's action as more akin to a soldier throwing himself on a grenade in order to save his fellow soldiers. Samson recognizes, I'm not going to leave this alive, so I'll give myself in order to defeat the enemy. And so he shows faith and obedience only there at the very, very end. So that brings us into the last section of Judges, where the downward spiral has been completed, chapters 17 through 21. And what these chapters do is they don't advance the story anymore. Rather, they just take two closer looks at what was going on in Israel during this time of the judges. If you were to read the opening three chapters, it reads like two introductions. Chapter one kind of gives you a summary of the activities where they're going in to take the land. And then chapter two almost reads like another introduction to the book that summarizes the book. So in the same way, at the end of the book, we have almost a double conclusion. Two stories that bring the book to a conclusion that show us how far down things have gotten with two stories, two windows into Israel during the time of the judges. Let me just summarize them for you, and then we'll draw some concluding thoughts from this book. One thing you'll see from these stories, by the way, one difference from the rest of the book, there's no mention of foreign invaders. Throughout the book, God has raised up foreign invaders to bring Israel to their senses. Civil war is the problem in these last chapters. The only thing worse than a foreign invasion is civil war. Because of their idolatry, because they've forsaken the Lord, God has given them over to themselves, and this is what happens. They tear and destroy one another. The first story is Micah and the idols from chapter 17 through 18. And basically what you have here is a young man named Micah who steals some silver from his mother. His mother pronounces a curse, and so he returns the silver to her. He repents. She is so delighted to get the silver back that she says, "Well, I'll dedicate this to the Lord." And so Micah lets make an idol out of the silver as a way of saying thank you to God for bringing my silver back. So they make the idol from the silver. A Levite, the priestly class, is passing by. He is hired by this family. The son hires him, he's from Bethlehem, to be a family priest. He's basically saying, "Hey, we got an idol, we'll hire you, pay you 10 shekels a year, give you food and clothing. You just be our family priest," their own private family priest. Don't serve at the central sanctuary. You just serve us. Well, Micah hears this and he thinks, this sounds like a good deal. So I will preside over the worship of this house. I'll help bring God's blessing to them. So he agrees. Next in the story, you have a group of Danites, people from the tribe of Dan, on their way to conquer a city, a quiet city, the text makes that note. Remember, they are still subduing the little pockets. And on the way, they see this Levite, and they say, hey, why don't you ask the Lord whether or not we should attack this city? Well, the priest of the idol says that the Lord is with them. They go on, and they conquer the city. So they're so happy that on their way back, they tell the Levite, hey, come and be our priest now. We'll give you more money. And think, you won't just be the priest over one family, you'll be the priest over an entire tribe. So it's a promotion. And Micah says, hey, or the priest says, hey, absolutely, I'll do it. Micah is upset. He wants his priest back. They threaten to kill him. They basically say, get out of here, or we'll get angry. And so they settle, the Danites settle in this land, and they worship the idol that Micah's mother had made. So that's just one story into Israel. Look at all the sin there. Idolatry. Priests for hire. You can't hire priests for your family and your tribe. They minister for all of Israel, the central sanctuary. There's theft, dishonoring of parents, threatened murder. Oaths are broken. Even though it's not an oath he should be making to serve the family, he breaks his contract and he goes on to serve another group of people. There's no justice there. So they're just robbed, and there's nothing that Micah and his family can do about it. And of course, sown throughout the whole story is just a complete misuse of religion, using the worship of God for personal means, personal profit, personal gain. Why are things so bad? Chapter 17, verse 6 says this: in those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as they saw fit. So there's story one. Story number two is the story of the Levite and his concubine, chapters 19 through 21, which begins with the same refrain, verse 1, in those days Israel had no king. And it starts out by telling us again about a Levite, one of the priests, who has a concubine. Now, Levites were not prohibited from getting married. They were not a celibate class. They were prohibited from having concubines. So what he basically has here is a concubine. He can't do that, but what it looks like is that he doesn't want to get married. So he basically wants to have a female companion, but he doesn't want to have the commitment and obligation of marriage. So she is basically a female slave to one of the priestly class people. Very wicked situation. She runs away and returns to her father's house. 4 months later, the Levite decides that he's going to go get her. So he goes to her father's house, and he negotiates for her with the father-in-law. So she is treated like property, and the father-in-law is happy to give her back to the Levite. As they travel home, they go through the tribe, the land of Benjamin. They find they're going to stay in the town square, but then an old man says, don't do that. Come and stay with me for the night. We quickly find out why, because a crowd gathers, and it's basically the same situation as what we read in the Sodom story, how the men came to the man of the house and made their different demands. The man of the house there says, don't take this man, take my daughter. And when they refuse that, the Levite sends his concubine out. She is killed and dies there at the break of day. She is abused through the night and dies at the break of day. The Levite comes out of the door and sees her dead body there, and he says, get up, let's go. Very callous, very uncaring. And when he realizes that she's died, he cuts her body in 12 pieces, and he sends them throughout the land of Israel, one piece to each tribe, in order to express his outrage. How dare you treat my property this way? So it's just a complete travesty of morals and mistreatment of God's image bearers and sins by every party involved. Now, the result is civil war. All the other tribes get their piece of the body and say, you know, you're right. That tribe of Benjamin's so wicked. We should go punish them for their ways. They come, and you know what? They even inquire of the Lord, and God says, okay, go do this, go do this. You may read and say, why is God telling them to go do this? Because he's saying, if you want to live in this sinful, wicked way, I'm just going to give you completely over to it. I'll let you go headlong into destruction. I'll even guide you to that very end because of your rebellion and sin. So they go, and they nearly wipe out the tribe of Benjamin. They realize, well, that's not good for us to wipe out a tribe. We need to rebuild this tribe. Well, none of us want to give any of the women from our tribe in marriage, so they go to another city and kidnap women from a religious festival and say, now you marry what's left of the tribe of Benjamin, and the tribe will grow again. And if you're disgusted by the story, you're supposed to be. Israel is a cesspool of sin. It is in utter ruin. It's disgusting how God's covenant people have started to act. Why are they doing this? Again, the concluding verse of the book, 21:25. In those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as they saw fit. You see, without Joshua no longer on the scene, without a righteous ruler to govern them, they do what they want. And when they do what they want, destruction is the result. Let me close. Let's make these three statements and close this book. We should read this book, particularly those last stories, and we should be repulsed. And we should look and we should say, that is wicked. And it is. But what God's word always wants to do is function like a mirror, so that when we see wickedness in Israel, we'll also see wickedness in ourselves. And every time we do what we want, we act just like those people. Every time we say, I'm not going to act the way God created me to act, I'm not going to act the way God commanded me to act, then we are doing what they did. Every time we harbor a grudge, every time we refuse to forgive, every time we lose our temper, when we covet and steal, when we lie to get someone else in trouble, when we lie to promote ourselves and make ourselves look good, when we dishonor our parents, when we ignore the worship that God has ordained and the times and seasons and the ways that he has ordained for us to worship, we are doing what they did. And like we're seeing in Galatians 5 in the morning, if we don't put sin to death, we don't nip it in the bud, so to speak, if we don't mortify and kill the desires of the flesh, that's what it will spiral down into. Again, it is very easy to look around at the surrounding culture and say, look, our culture is doing this, and maybe they are. But where we have to look first and foremost is at ourselves. Am I hardening my heart against God's word? Am I nursing temptation? I think it's John Owen that said, temptation is a knife. It'll cut your throat if you're not careful. And when we nurse temptation, when we give in to sin, we start the process that culminates in that kind of living. Be warned. 2, God chooses in his mercy to rescue people who are guilty of such sins. That is wicked. And that's the kind of wicked people that Christ came and died for. They needed a righteous ruler so that they wouldn't do what they wanted to do and destroy themselves. This is the nation to which God sent Messiah Jesus, the Son of God, who loves us and died for us and has brought us into his nation. Why? To keep us from doing this, to change our hearts, and to be the righteous ruler who won't give in to the sins that these rulers gave into, who won't be like Samson, but who will be the king we need to save us from our ways. I steal this point from Aaron. He made that point this in Sunday school this morning. Yes, the next generation forsook the Lord, and it almost looked like everything came undone. But what did God promise through Moses? One generation will forsake the Lord, but I'll renew my covenant with the next. And so even though things got so bad here, God's kingdom didn't disappear. God said, I'll keep my promises to save my people. And he sent Christ to save them. And third and final point, and I'll just mention this quickly. You can read this book and you might think everything's gone wrong. And in one sense, you are supposed to think that. But guess what? God always has his remnant. There's one other book of the Bible that is set during the time of Judges. A very short book, and it follows Judges in the English Bible, the book of Ruth. What do you see in the book of Ruth? Godly Boaz doesn't mistreat the poor, doesn't mistreat Ruth, doesn't take advantage of the weak. Ruth, a foreigner, joins the people of God. And you would think, who would ever convert to the people of God when they're acting like this? Well, God always has his remnant. He always has those who have not bowed the knee to Baal and preserves his people. Let's give thanks for that together. Father in heaven, thank you for the grace of God and Christ our Lord.